Hello everyone, in this lecture we will be discussing image formation. Followed by sampling and quantization techniques. Basically, the sampling and quantization will be carried out in terms of image. Once we have clear understanding of what sampling and quantization is in relation to images, we will go forward in the next lecture and deal with mathematical expressions. To further enhance our understanding for sampling and quantization. So let's start. So if you see this slide, this is basically the slide which shows how images actually form using digital camera. We can see here that we have sunlight falling onto the object, and once it falls onto the object, it reflects some part of its energy and absorbs some of it. So the part of the energy which is reflected passes through the digital camera. You can see this is a digital camera. It's a very idealized version of the digital camera, which has only the lens on it. So the light passes through this lens and falls onto the discrete array of sensors which is shown here. So this is basically a discrete sensor which is present inside the camera, which we cannot see by ourselves, but it is present within the camera. So it's like it's an idealized situation where we have this as our lens for the camera, and this is the basic CCD circuit which is present inside the camera. So this is how basically an image which is present in the real situation gets captured using the camera. So this slide shows how image is captured using the digital camera and what is the basic flow for this. Here we can see we have an image acquired through lens of the digital camera. This is a real image. This is the image which is in the real situation. So once it is acquired through the lens, we have a charge coupled device circuitry inside, which tries to sense the light which falls onto this real object, and it's coming through the lens onto this circuitry. So once this charge coupled device receives the light, it is fed into the analog to digital converter. This analog to digital converter performs sampling and quantization task, which we'll be discussing in the coming slides. So once that is done, we have two paths to this circuit. One is what we call as a raw data file, which is basically the output of this analog digital converter, and the size of this raw data file is very heavy. And the other way is to go straight into this image processing engine. This image processing engine is basically the process which involves different type of image processing tasks, such as production of RGB images, brightness enhancement, adjustment, white balance adjustments, sharpness adjustments, and contrast adjustments. All these are image processing tasks which are actually being performed inside the camera module. So once we perform all these image processing tasks, it is then fed back to the compression processing circuitry, which performs compression. And it depends whether you want to perform the compression or not. If you don't want to perform the compression, then you can go by this path. And finally, the whole image which is captured through the original scene here gets fed into the memory card. This is what we can see in our laptops and PCs, and we can observe our images in computer. So in order to start with this process in details, let's discuss the charge coupled device which we are showing here onto the next slide. You can see this charge coupled device is basically a material made up of semiconductor devices. takes the energy from the reflected light that is coming from the object, and that energy passes into this sensing material, and what comes out is the waveform, which is the waveform which has to be processed by the analog to digital converter. So this is only one unit of CCD. So we have here in this circuitry a 1D alignment of CCD, where each individual CCDs are stacked in columns in order to produce a single row. In a similar way, if it is stacked in rows and columns, we will achieve a two-dimensional sensing matrix, where each individual block is basically a charge coupled device, which is what is shown over here. So all these sensing materials will generate some voltage signals, which will be then tapped into analog to digital converter in order to produce a raw data file, or it will be processed into further image processing applications, as we have discussed just a slide before. So here what we are seeing is just to show a comparative analysis between the small number of CCD pixels and a very high density of CCD pixels. So what we see here is when we are using large number of CCD pixels, the quality of the image is much better as compared to the case when there is small number of CCD pixels. So once we have finished the role of CCD, now we will discuss analog to digital converter. As you know, the analog to digital converters convert an analog signal into its digital counterpart. And in order to do so, what it requires is two types of operations. One is sampling and another is quantization. So analog signals basically go through sampling and quantization so that they can produce digital signals. So in the next slide, what we will be discussing is sampling operation. What we see here is the same image as we have started with in the very first slide, but the only difference is you can see here is that the image that we obtain here is a sampled version, whereas in the earlier case it was the original image. So this is basically the sampling operation that has to be carried out in case of ADC. As you can see, this image is basically the same image as we have seen earlier, but the only difference is that the sampled image is somewhat, you can see, a hazy looking image. This is actually a sampled image. What the sensor is actually doing is, we can see over here, in this we have this continuous image which is transformed into the sampled image. But the way it is being done is, the original image is basically divided into discrete grids. So for each discrete grid, we are actually calculating average intensity in one small square block, and we are actually averaging the intensity of the square blocks, and what we are registering here are this average intensities for that particular block. So if we look in terms of the mathematical expression, then the ISRC, which is the sampled image, can be represented in terms of the original image IC rho x as R delta to R plus 1 delta C delta to C plus 1 delta, and we have here is delta x. So these integrations are basically carried out onto a small box, and this small box is basically a small box that we are looking over here. So we are basically averaging the intensities, and what we get at the end is average color in this box, and we replace that average color in this box over here. So this is what we get. So once we operate this integral onto the whole image, what we get at the output is the sample image, which is shown over here. Here we show the MATLAB code for. So here we show the MATLAB code for sampling operation. So the first line shows that we are reading one image which we already have in our database. The second line shows we are actually calculating the size of these images, and the size of the row will be in the J, the column will be in the K, and the channel will be in C. So in this case, since our image is a RGB image, so the C will be equal to 3, and J and K will be the respective rows and columns of the image. So now this line shows that we are scaling the size to 25. That is, if we have an original image of size 500 by 500, so it will be downscaled to 500 by 25 500 by 25. So if that scale is 5, then it will be 500 by 5. So it depends how much scale you are using. So this scale is actually mimicking the sensor size. By saying the scale of 25, we means we have, suppose let us say, the sensor size of 25 by 25, and if we say that our scale is 5, that means we have a small sensor of size 5 cross 5. So in total we will have a small number of sensors in it. So what we can see here is, if the sensor size is large, suppose it's 25 cross 25, then the quality of the image that we will obtain will be really high. But in case when the sensor size is small, that is 5 cross 5, then the quality of the image that we obtain here will be a little less degraded compared to the earlier case when we are using 25 cross 25. So the other two lines are basically rounding off this, and it's creating a new variable x new and y new, which is basically the original size of the image divided by the scale that we are using, and we are rounding it off to get some variable x new and y new. So when we compare the old dimensions to that of the new dimensions that we have to obtain, that means old dimensions means, for example, 500 cross 500, and the new dimensions is 500 by 25 and 500 by 25. So in order to obtain the scale for that, what we are actually calculating is the scaling parameters that are x scale and y scale here. And once we do that, in the next line, what we are doing is we are initializing an array with the size x new, y new, and the channel C. So x new and y new are basically the new variables, or the what you can say is the new image that we are actually targeting on. So in this code, what you can see here is we are running a for loop from ch equal to 1 into the C, that is the number of channels in the image, and another variable is running up to the new variable x new, and the third one is running up to the y new. So what we are getting here is the downscaled image compared to the original image. Right. So once we obtain M, which is a downscale version of the original image I, we display both of them simultaneously. So what results we will be getting here is these. You can see this is actually, you can say it's an original image or something close to the original image, this one. What what we see here is the, what we are using is a scale of 15. So what you can see here is we have little artifacts onto the rose petals, whereas this has no artifacts at all. But when we reduce the scale to another one of, let us say, 25, the artifacts that you can see here becomes more pronounced and the rose image becomes more and more prone to artifacts. So when we compare this to the sensor image sensor size, what we observe is if we have a larger sensor here, then what we get is a very good quality image. But if we reduce the size of the sensor as shown on this slide, then the quality of the image gets a little bit degraded. And when even the sensor size are very small, then the degradation is more and more pronounced. It doesn't mean that the quality of the images are bad here and here, but it is because since we are zooming it to the original level here, the quality becomes more and more degraded. So this finishes off with the sampling of the signal. And now we will head towards the quantization, which is another part of ADC circuitry. So once we have sampled the signal, so it's necessary to quantize the amplitude of the signal that we have obtained. For in that case, we can see here on this slide, over here we have continuous colors that we are having on our image. So our aim is to convert this continuous color input into the discrete color counterpart. So what we use here is this quantizer signal, which we are showing in black lines. And what the characteristic of this quantizer is, it quantizes the signal into its discrete colors as shown on y-axis. For example, let us focus our interest on this area. What you can see is we have continuous color variation over this side, but this all continuous color variation is mapped onto a single color onto the y-axis. Consider this situation. Here we have a continuous color on x-axis and this is mapped to a discrete color given on this side. So basically all the continuous color amplitudes are mapped onto the discrete color outputs. On the right side we can see an image which is basically a real image, let us say. So if we do a quantization of this real image, we will obtain something like this, and you can see over here, if I zoom a bit, you can see here we have some sharp edges here, but here it is quite continuous. So this continuous variation in the colors is mapped into a discrete color contour. So this continuous color is mapped onto the discrete colors. This is what is actually stated over here. This is basically the MATLAB code for quantization. As you can see, what we are doing is we are reading an image. As we have now 256 levels of colors, we are quantizing up to 5 levels, let us say. So this code corresponds to the quantizer code that we have seen. This is basically a quantizer characteristic plot. So what it is doing is, it is basically plotting this black curve. So once that is done, we are basically calculating the discrete value image using this code. Once that is done, we will plot the quantizer plot as well as the image itself, that is the quantized image itself. So this shows the output of the above MATLAB code. Here we are using L is equal to 2, here L is equal to 6, and here L is equal to 15. So basically we have 2 level of quantization here. Here we have 6 levels of quantization, that is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. here we have 15 level of quantization. So we have 15 number of steps on which we are quantizing our continuous value of input. So what results we get after applying this quantization signal is this. Here you can see only two colors are prominent, one is this and one is this. So basically there are two levels of quantization here, that is the continuous range of color inputs are mapped into two discrete levels. In this case, the continuous range of gray inputs are mapped into six different levels, and in this case the continuous input is mapped into 15 different color levels. So you can see here there are some contourings coming up in the background image, whereas this is not the case when level of 15 is used. This image is basically quite close to the original image. However, this is somewhat in middle means somewhat mediocre quality of image as compared to the original image, whereas this is completely different from that of the original image, where we have only two colors which are prominent here.